next, dann so at the time so reductus sort of dipole blockade or whipple blockade staircase, which ideally you could climb up. Just by changing your laser detuning in a slow fashion. And what means slow here? So slow actually means this, that you don't want to excite this massive spaghetti opulence. So this is now sort of a diagonalization of this whole in-body system with a linear chain of 30 atoms. So pretty much twice as large as this cartoon one that I showed before. And what you see here now, so this is for a finite Rabi frequency, and what this actually does is that it takes this essentially this purple line that you see here, so it is just connecting sort of these low states, and if you crank up the Rabi frequency large enough, so large enough now you really depends on your interactions. So if you overcome the interaction energy, then you start to sort of split away this entire ground state. And once you do that, then you can change your Rabi, your laser detuning and sort of move along this lowest line, and the idea then would be to turn the Rabi frequency off again, and then hopefully you end up in some sort of more long-range ordered state. So that seems kind of simple. So the idea seems simple, then for these systems, at the time we did this for a dense extended cloud, so this also worked quite well. So now we try to do this for these Munich experiments, where you have these regular arrangements with much less atoms, and that really turned out that it gets quite challenging to actually get to these regimes where the system becomes slower, so adiabatic, and you can still beat the lifetime, for the finite lifetime of these Rydberg states. But what really helps you is now really to look at the static structure of your parameter space. So in our case, so this is for rubidium 43S states. This would just be the laser detuning and your intensity, your Rabi frequency. And what I'm plotting here is now the average number of excitations. Choose the strange color code so that you actually see some of the structure, because if you're dealing with a finite system, sort of all your observables will still be smoothly changing, so there's not really sort of phase transitions going on here as for this Ising model that I showed. So let's put this in quotation marks, but you can really see that there are some different regimes. So here along this line, so you have pretty much two excitations, and in this part you have one excitation, and here you get precisely three excitations, so there really seems to be some resemblance of the large system phase diagram. But so this is just it's just some fakes so coming from this color code, which you see when you look now at the Q parameters. So that's what we just said before, right? So if you want to have a crystalline state, you only want to have sort of this particular number of excitations in the system, and not just an average two or an average three. So really to get an idea of this phase space or parameter space, you have to look at both of these quantities, and the red region here basically gives you the region where you have a Fock state, right? So your fluctuations really vanish. And if you look closely here, then there's really like a small tongue coming out, so these two parts are separated. And if you compare that to this one, then you really see that in this large region you have three excitations, and there's this tiny little dimple where you might hope to be able to compare two excitations. And that's not really what we are what we try to do in the experiment. So really now we're using some pulse, so the question was, can we steer to these different regions to see some crystalline behavior. But before I show some results, so let's just sort of look at the Hamiltonian again and try to understand where these different regions actually lie now in a more general setting, sort of for different interactions and different system sizes and so on. And this is quite simple to understand, at least for this simple 1D configuration, so when one extent is much bigger than the other extent of your 2D lattice, so then you just have to write down these classical energies. So we drop this laser coupling again and just look at the total energy again. And if this is 1D, so then you can write down your potential energy just by, or you can estimate your potential energy just by the nearest neighbors. Right? So if you have two atoms, then there's just C over L to the 6. If you have three atoms, then you have just three guys, and the interaction would be 2 times L half to the 6, and so on and so on. And in the end, so the effective lattice spacing for these Rydberg excitations that you put in would just be L over number of atoms to the minus 1. And there would be n minus 1 different possibilities to all simple expression. And now if you ask sort of where the space transition is sitting, then you just have to compare, you just have to equate these two energies, so for n excitations and for n plus one excitations. And this is this quite simple relation of what is critical to tuning, sort of that separate these different different orders states. And as you see, there is this simple scaling, which now means, for example, in the experiment, so depending what you like better, you can sort of vary your detuning, which sometimes is harder, or it's totally equivalent to keep your laser pulse fixed. So if you have optimized it for one particular configuration, then you just change the size of your system and you should be able to scan over this whole phase diagram. So that's shown here now. So this is a pulse that we in the end came up with after doing some optimization, sort of which now connects in this case sort of the ground state initially, so large negative detuning. So the zero atoms, that's where you start your experiment, and it connects to the triply excited state. So what's shown here, so this is for 23 atoms in your longitudinal direction. As I just explained, if you could now go to the smaller sizes, then essentially all you do is sort of stretching the scale of this sort of the states or of the response of your Rydberg system, and if you keep the pulse fixed, then automatically at some point you will sort of move into a different state. So in this sense, just by changing the system size, you can now scan at least over this vertical axis here of your phase diagram. Okay, so this is how the pulse now looks in time. So as I said, so this is for these kind of small systems, it's really challenging to be able to do this in a short time, in this case for microseconds, which is necessary to really keep as much coherence as you want. And this is what you get. And this is what you obtain in theory, so really the ideal case, so just this two-level system, no dephasing, no decay, and no sort of motion of the atoms, for example, this surely also arises if you bring them up to these formally entire states. So then in the best case, so this is for this part, it's what you get, so more than 95% population in the triply excited state. Okay, so then from this numerics, if you now really do the dynamics in contrast to what I've shown before, then you also expect to see this kind of staircase behavior now, just by changing the system size, so always keeping this pulse on and now just changing the size. You still see some kind of sharp increases of the number distribution. If you now put some deficiencies in, experimental deficiencies that you have in the experiment, in this case, it's only a detection efficiency, so 62%. So assuming basically that the full dynamics is perfectly following what you expect from this, from the ideal theory, and only adding some sort of 62% loss, so either from indirect detection or from just from loss of the atoms, then this curve that you obtain. And since you have a Fock state, essentially these plateaus are not getting washed out. If you wouldn't have these Fock states, so this whole thing would be smeared out, because any n sort of wave function or n excitation wave function contribution gets changed, of course, differently by this efficiency, but if I have this Fock state, nothing changes, right? You just shift it down. So that's what you obtain, and then okay, that's the final part. So luckily, so that's a very recent measurement, so just 2 days before Christmas, actually, they sent us these data, and it really fits now very nicely to what you predict in the theory. So that's using really this one pulse and simply adding one by one layer to this model insulating state, and then it really seems to nicely can map out this type of blockade staircase. All right, so that's pretty much the main message I wanted to get across for this first part. So really looking at these simple systems. So just for a start, essentially.
Can I ask? Yes.
That's essentially it's the same one, like what I showed where the one in Munich at MPU. I measure the dynamics, so now they basically really do the same thing, except that your system is not round anymore, it's an effective 1D system, and they do these pulse excitations. So I didn't have data for the frequency and for the intensity, but they really can manage to pretty much resemble what you presented from the theory side. And it actually turns out that like this adiabatic correlation is much easier for reasons that we don't at the moment understand fully for 1D systems than it would be for 2D systems. It's of course also nicer because if you now do this imaging, you won't have these rotation issues. It's really, you see when you have a fox tail, basically in the experiment, you see these nice local excitation spots also in the smaller patterns. All right, so that's pretty much it. So for the first lecture, this is really just a simple message that you can, or at least things look quite promising now for using these Rydberg lattices or Rydberg atoms in general as quantum simulators. Charles also mentioned this just several times. So really seems, despite the fact that your Rydberg atoms are quite complicated objects with many levels in general, that you can have situations where they follow a simple two-level system, so that the experiments are really not far away from making some serious sort of attempts at simulating spin physics. So what you now are really getting to this, well, if experiments get to the stage, now you can extend this and some steps further. So for example, also generate entanglements. So for large atoms, for large numbers of atoms, I think Mark will talk about this. Other approaches, more advanced approaches, probably in more detail. So now if you just extend these things that I've talked about, so there's immediately one simple way of getting some sort of simple entangled states. And this is just by using a different sign of the interaction. So here I'm just replotting this level structure that I now showed several times. So this is now on a larger scale of your frequency detuning. So if you zoom in here, that's actually the regime that I've been talking about. But it's this very tiny scale here, we have this many level crossings. And here there is one exceptional point. Basically, where the bound state crosses this line here. This is also a point that I talked about in the beginning, so anyone still remembers? So what this point actually, also what happens at this point? So that's actually the case where you realize this transverse isomorphism. That's interesting now. I'm going to say so now. So this is really the point if you go to very, very large detuning, so when you beat your interaction strength, then your ground state actually becomes degenerate with this most energetic state. So still with excitation numbers, excitation fraction less than 1/2, and here really what I just said, right? So here these two states become degenerate, your system becomes totally symmetric, and that's essentially the only point where you can do analytical, where you find an analytical solution of this entire system, including laser coupling and so on. So now if you look at this and now sort of think about what happens if you change your interactions, then of course you will also have this particular point. But the total level structure, and that I found quite interesting, is changing quite drastically, right? So, and it changes because now you're only flipping the sign of the interaction, but you keep the scale of your detuning still the same, right? So what happens is that you don't just flip this whole thing, but as I said, so you really flip the total structure, and now there's only one crossing between the ground state and this, and one of these excited states. So if I only look at the ground state, the only one phase transition, even though I'm having these low range interactions, which is completely different from this repulsive case. And in this I can now describe much easier, but if I have only this one transition between these two states, I can actually describe this with a simple Niels-Neymar model, get analytical solutions and so on. And this also has some relevance. So for example, if you look at S-states or strontium, there you actually have these attractive interactions, and there are also experiments for one with Durham, for example, in the John School, where they really try to coherent excitations with strontium atoms. But what's nice here is if you look at these two crossings here, then you see that the energy difference to these higher excited states, so that would produce some complicated massive dynamics, is quite large, right? So you get these two degenerate states, but actually the energy to the next state is quite high, so that's on the order of the nearest neighbor interaction. So these are very separated, and that means that around this detuning region, I can actually really work with the it's just these two many-body states, so actually everything up and everything down. And now a very simple thing you could do is simply put yourself with a laser detuning onto this point. Then you turn your laser field on, but suddenly or slowly and cover these two states, then you could split the gap. You get some couplings between these two states. And actually you just shoot a pulse, if you wish, right? And if you do that, as I said, you get a coupling between these two states, but only between these states, and because these are very far away, as I said, in energy. And then what you then get is almost for free, so essentially this superposition between this GHD state, so this totally coherent superposition between everything on the ground state and everything on the work state. And that this really works is shown here. So basically, this is now time dependence of the population of either of these two. So everything on ground is blue, everything up is shown in red, as a function now simply of your laser pulse. So this is just a Gaussian pulse with a length scale, a length on the scale of your interactions, and you really see if you make this long enough, then you basically you only excite these two many body states, and you get sort of these GHD states with an arbitrary arbitrary fraction of the two. So that's why that could be one simple extension that you could do in a lattice, or again of any dimension, one would work equally well. Now, sort of again, now in this context of quantum simulations, now really hoping that this would sometimes work quite well, and you can also think about extensions and really put this onto a practical level, so hoping to simulate also models that you can solve as easily anymore on a computer. So this is really where these things, or if you seriously think about it, you should try to push this at some point. So for example, you can actually get such models that are beyond current computational capabilities, for example, already by adding some hopping dynamics into the system. So here for three states, so one ground state, two Rydberg states. So what you then get, and this is just some simple example, so some kind of spin one system, which are non-classical, right? So now I have a hopping even without a laser field, so the final ground state after turning the field on would be fully quantum, so not just these classical box states. And for example, here, so these are simulations for a 1D chain. And you already find some interesting physics, so this, which one would call a spin liquid, so where you get some non-trivial ordering along the sigma x direction now, but so now there's some, like an interfer magnet in the x direction coming from the hopping, emerging in the ground state. So, and as I said, so in 1D, these simulations are still possible at the moment. In 2D, essentially no one knows what's going to happen. Already for this quite simple situation. So this would be certainly useful and interesting if one could implement this at some point in experiments. Then this would be rightfully called for the quantum simulator. Alright, so with this I think I should end this first part and thank the people that were involved in the things that I showed. So essentially most of this lecture on the Dresden side was done by Tommaso Macri, postdoc. Our group in Dresden and the experiment, as I said several times, by Emanuel Bloch. And this was essentially for me, outlook.